still rocking after all these years.
This is the story of my rock and roll butler.
This is it, the show that started it all. Often imitated, but never equal. From San Francisco, USA, online since 2004, it's the one and only Rock and Roll Geek Show with the original Rock and Roll Geek, Michael Butler.
Welcome to the Rock and Roll. I can't hear myself. Okay, hello, friends. Welcome to the Rock and Roll Geek Show. My name's Michael Butler. Thanks a lot for joining me. I really appreciate it. Today is Thursday, April 22nd, 2021, and it is 6:53 p.m. when I'm recording this episode. I don't know if you know or not. You probably do if you're a regular listener of the Rock and Roll Geek Show, but I have a donation level where if you donate $100, you are welcome to co-host the Rock and Roll Geek Show with your friend Michael Butler here. And that's what I'm doing tonight. I have a friend of the show, longtime friend of the show, Rob. How do you pronounce your last name, Rob?
Giglio.
Giglio. I call you Giglio. I don't know why.
But yeah.
Well, that's how the Hicks say it.
Well, no, I believe me. I'm used to it. You know what's funny is I always sort of dreaded the first day of school, you know, when teachers had to pronounce your name because it always would get massacred. And then when David Lee Roth came out when I'm Just a Gigolo, right. Of course, everyone pronounced my name Gigolo.
Rob Gigolo. Well, that would be a compliment when you're a kid in school.
Yeah, not so bad, right? Yeah, not so bad thing. So.
Giglio?
Yeah, second G silent. You know, the American eyes, they say, people say Giglio.
Yeah.
I've heard Giglio and Giglio, depending on, where you are.
The Hicks say Giglio.
Yeah. No, that's pretty common, though. I had Julio a lot, anyway.
Where are you located?
I live in the suburbs of, right outside of Philadelphia.
Philly. Giants just took 2 out of 3 from the Phillies.
They sure did. Unfortunately for you, I guess, Phillies fans were not very happy with Gabe Kapler, so they were very happy to see him go.
Oh, that's right. He's an ex-Philly. They're mad that he left?
No, they were happy he left. Philly fans are pretty brutal.
He got fired? Did he get fired from Philly?
Yeah, I think he was here 2 or 3 years, you know. He got a lot of shit because, you know,
he probably won't be with the Giants that long. I don't know. Maybe he will. Giants front office is kind of they kind of sign people to longer contracts.
Yeah. Yeah. So the Phillies new coach is the guy from he used to coach the Yankees. So I can't think of his name. Anyways. Yeah. He's been here. This will be his third season.
Good.
Joe Girardi, I think his name. Yeah. So, yeah.
Well, anyway, I don't
know. Yeah.
It's baseball.
We digress.
Yeah. So you play in Cream Circus. That's right. That's you, right?
That is correct. Yeah, I play drums in Cream Circus.
Cream Circus, great band.
Thank you very much. Well, real quick, I had a whole joke lined up. I was going to say long time listener, first time caller.
Uh-huh, so, okay. Say it. So go ahead. Say it. I'm on the hello
I just
caller.
Said it. That's terrible. And just one other thing I wanted to say is, like, you had such a great lineup of guests recently, like Keith Morrison, and of course Susie Quattro, and that guy, was it Frank? From the Street Walking Genius?
Frank Meyer, yeah.
Meyer, yeah, he was amazing. And, like, does the guy ever sleep? Like, I was,
yeah,
like,
no.
The guy's very accomplished. I was like, I felt very lazy around him. Like, he's a
braggart.
video producer, director, author,
right?
Musician, producer.
And he just did a documentary or some kind of movie that just won a Film Threat Award too.
Oh yeah, good. Yeah, no, he was really entertaining. Going off another tangent, but I guess we'll talk about that later. It's just I had a friend of mine working on a doc. I thought maybe you know, the fans of the Rock and Roll Geek Show would be interested in. He's doing the official Dio doc.
Oh, really? Huh.
Yeah. So
it's is it a biopic or just a documentary on Dio?
I think it's a bio. I think there's definitely going to be some like flashback scenes and stuff.
I think I heard Eddie Trunk talking about that.
Yeah, he's a Philadelphia guy. It's him. His name's Don Argot. His company's called 914, and it's him and Demian and his wife Sheena, and they're, you know, they do a lot of docs. They did the I don't know if you've ever seen the Bobby Liebling, the Pentagram doc, Last Days Here. That was them as well.
No, I didn't see it. Oh, about the band, the band Pentagram. Yeah, I think I did see.
Well, it's about Bobby, but yeah.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah. So there, you know. Anyway, it's, I don't know how I got down that road, but I think someone posted it on your Facebook page, yeah, something mentioning that coming out. So that's pretty cool.
So Cream Circus is, who are the people in Cream Circus? What's the rest of the guys in the band's names?
Well, it's always a revolving door, but currently, well, it's obviously Chris DePinto is his baby.
Now DePinto, he's the guitar maker.
That is correct. Yes.
He's I have one of his, maker. I think I have one of his basses, or I might've just sold it.
Yeah. I think you were nice enough, I think, to play us a few years ago. I sent you something and I think you mentioned it, that you didn't realize that he was in the band, that you had one of his basses. Yeah, so
he's not affiliated with the band Waltham or Damone, those guys, is he?
Not that I know of, no. I mean,
okay.
As far as I know, you know.
So is he still in the band? DePinto still in the band?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. It's his baby, yes. I'm just kind of joking because we've had a big lineup, a lot of people in the band.
Is he still doing the guitars?
Yeah. He still has his company and, makes guitars.
Aren't those guitars Korean made? Aren't they from Korea?
Depends on the model. And then some of them, and even though I don't want to speak for him because I don't really know his whole, how things work, but even the stuff he will get from Korea or China is almost, he goes through and redoes them by hand as well.
Oh, does. Okay. Well, the bass I had was really nice. I needed the money and I never played it. So it was really cool looking bass. So I ended up selling it because I needed the money.
What did you have, a Belvedere or a?
It was a semi hollow body and was black and it had sparkle,
probably
stars on the fretboard.
That's cool guitar.
It was a cool looking bass.
I just had
so many basses and I needed the money really bad and I never played. I never even took it out of the case except to see if it worked.
That's too bad.
I didn't.
Did you get a good penny for it?
I don't remember what sold it for.
I'm curious what they go for, because it's funny, he's got a couple models he only made a handful of, and they said there's one called the Throwing Star, and there's two of them. And, I'm always, always curious as to what he ends up getting for them. But I know the Throwing Star, I think it was going for like $2,500 or $3,000, something like that.
No, I didn't get anywhere near that.
Yeah.
I had another one too. I might still have it. It's a knockoff of an Ampeg. Remember the Ampeg scroll headstock basses, the way the body looked?
Oh yeah. He had one of those in the shop recently.
I still have that, I think, or I might have sold that too, but I still have that. It's not a scroll headstock, but the body style is the same, and it's got the F holes in the body style.
Yeah, that's a
It's a solid
cool
body, but it's got F holes.
Yeah,
I have. Yeah. I actually have the real Ampeg too. It's called an AEB something.
Oh wow, that's awesome! How many basses do you have?
More than 30.
I love it, man. That's awesome.
That's why I sold the DePinto, because I have so many fucking basses.
That's a lot. My my wife plays bass and my son is a bass player as well. I have an 18-year-old son. And
nice.
See, we have a lot of, as a matter of fact, I'm sitting in a room that we have a little practice room, and we have a it's actually mine. I have it. It's like a 72 or 73P. That was kind of willed to me from one of my mom's friends, even though I don't play bass and I'm a drummer. But that thing is it gets a lot of use. It's very popular.
Yeah, I have a 60s Tobacco Sunburst P bass that I played. Yeah. I played on the Butler's not the last one, but the Butler's acoustic live stream that we did, and I'll probably be playing on the next one. That's a really nice bass. I never play. Never play it on stage electric because it's not. Smash up, it's not worthy of getting taken a lot of
I know. I could definitely see that. Like mine's a tobacco with a tortoise shell
Same. I broke the pick. The pick guard's broken, so the jack wiggles a little bit. So
yeah. It's funny because I was in bands for a while, and like the bass player always had a crappy bass, and I always just like, please just use this so I can at least hear it, so you can cut through the mix, you know?
Yeah, that P bass I have is really, really. It's probably the one of the nicer basses I have, but yeah. I only really play two basses live. So
yeah, what do you normally use?
I got to turn off the Facebook. I usually play these Hagstrom Swedes that I modified.
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah, since I've been in Cream Circus, I've learned a lot about guitars, as you can imagine. So, yeah.
So who else is in Cream Circus besides...
Chris DePinto, it's his baby. He writes, he's his lead singer, lead guitar player. And a gentleman by the name of Ben Brower is playing second lead guitar. And... Gloria is our bass player. And of course, at this very moment, I totally forgot.
Gloria, is that your wife?
Gloria Goodrich.
So your wife plays bass?
No. My wife does not play bass in the band. No, that was, it's funny because I that was, could have been an option at one point, but the scheduling didn't make sense.
You don't want to play in a band with your wife. That's
it's funny you should say that because, you know, yes, that since we were in a band together and then we started dating, and got married, and since then haven't been in a band together, and that was one of the reasons, like, you know, let's not ruin our marriage by being in a band together. So,
but having said that, Casey from Featherwitch plays in is with right. one of the singers from Featherwitch, so you know, but she's super hot, so I mean that's
yeah, well, my wife's really hot too, but it's tough being, I always said that being in a band is, it's kind of like dating a bunch of other people too. And my other project, Beretta 76, which doesn't really play too much due to scheduling, but they're a married couple, and they make it work. But it's kind of funny. But
does Cream Circus play all originals?
Yeah.
Well, you sent me The Wanderer. You sent me a cover, but
yeah, that was we just happened to do that as a single. But I mean, you know, our set is 99% originals.
Uh-huh.
I mean, every so often we'll throw a cover in, you know, usually it's along those lines, something like an old rock and roll song is kind of revved up a little bit. So, but, and it's funny, we don't really do any glam covers and like, you know, we don't really play T-Rex songs or Sweet songs or anything like that. But
what are the covers that you do?
we used to do a revved up version of She Caught the Katie. I remember, I don't know if Taj Mahal wrote it, but like it's that song, but it kind of, you know, kind of like imagine, kind of like Foghat, you know what I mean?
Right,
like,
yeah. Well, right.
That kind of straight ahead kind of. The Wanderer. We do a different arrangement of I Want to Hold Your Hand. That's kind of a new addition to the set that we started playing right before the pandemic. Occasionally about a sort of a 60s garage arrangement of Can't Explain, you know, just like a standard.
What's the situation in Philadelphia now with the Corova?
Well, you know, I'm assuming I know every state's different, every city's different, but things are starting to open up. You know, we're not in lockdown. There's restaurants are open. They're at, I don't know what the capacity is, but they're open. And there's people back in Philly's games. There's people at the Sixers games, I think. So it's slowly getting there. I'm curious how you feel about this and what it's like out there, but I have no concept of when any kind of live music's going to happen. I did see there's a club called the Ardmore Music Hall, which is a pretty nice place out in the suburbs, they just announced some dates in May, but I don't know if they're going to just be streaming. But it does seem like stuff's happening, but just very, very slowly.
So bars are not having bands yet.
No, not to my knowledge. And unfortunately, a lot of clubs, clubs went under, because of the COVID. A place called the Boot and Saddle, which is a great, local, indie rock, punk rock club. And it was also cool too. I'm sorry.
I played somewhere in Philadelphia when I was in Exodus, open for Body Count at a theater. What was that place called?
TLA was on South Street.
What's the name of the place?
TLA, or the Theater of the Living Arts.
That doesn't sound familiar.
And it was, but it was in the Philadelphia proper?
It was in the city, yeah.
Was it in Chinatown? It was at Trocadero?
Maybe it was a truck. I don't know. Anyway, so I'm digressing. So I'm playing.
No, that's cool. Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead. Stay on Philly. I'm changing the subject. Go ahead.
No. I'm curious to, like, so I'm, like, one of the things I wanted to mention. So Ben Brower, who plays guitar with us, he's a multi-instrumentalist, and he actually played drums with Cream Circus before I joined the band. But he used to play drums in Adam West, and he said he played
tour with American Heart with Adam West. Yeah.
Yeah. So he, when I guess your name came up when he joined the, when he came back in the band, I don't know, like two and a half years ago.
Did he say anything bad about our singer?
No, not at all. He said, Michael Butler, I remember he was in American Heartbreak. And I'm like, yeah. Which, by the way, you guys, American Heartbreak is amazing.
Oh, I thanks. Tell you,
I think he's a great band.
The bass player for Adam West, I'm pretty sure it was Adam West, got really pissed off. We did a whole tour with Adam West. Man, he booked it. Anyway, the bass player got really pissed off at our singer because he said something before the first gig. They were opening for us, and he goes, "Oh, you guys did really good. Thanks for warming them up for us." And that bass player got so fucking pissed, and I thought he was going to kick his ass, and it kind of made it a little tense for most of the tour.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah, we were. Lance managed to embarrass us a little bit. Actually, a lot.
Yeah, that's funny. So how many days was that?
Oh, shit, we did like, every time we did Europe, it was like 6 weeks.
Wow, man, that's amazing.
Yeah, Adam West guys, they were good guys. We had a good time with those guys.
Yeah, they were a great band. Beretta band, the other band playing, we played with them many years ago. I think they're Baltimore, D.C. based. They're not Philly based. I'm not sure how Ben hooked up with them, but.
Yeah, I think they are D.C. That sounds familiar.
Yeah. So you see, I'm trying to figure the club. What year would that have been when you played with Body Count?
It was around 92, something like that. 91, 92.
And what band was it you were playing with?
That was Exodus.
It was Exodus, yeah. So how did you get, like, one of the reasons I wanted to do this because I had questions for you. And, like, I find you incredibly fascinating. And when I first discovered the show, you know, I thought it was definitely more like 70s oriented, you know, like,
yeah.
Cheap Trick and
right,
and all the stuff I love. And then I find out you have this whole like punk rock side, which I also love. And so it was, you know, it's kind of interesting to hear. And like, how did you get in? So how did you make it your way into Exodus? I mean, I always want to say Testament. I apologize. I always think those two bands.
Yeah, I get confused. I was in a punk rock band that moved out to San Francisco. And
right.
We played and we burnt some bridges. And we were Stevie Saletta. We were one of the original hardcore bands from Florida, like in the 80s. And we moved out to San Francisco and we got a following. And one of the guys who used to come to the show named Danny, Stevie Saletta broke up. And Danny just contacted me and said, "Hey, Exodus is looking for a bass player. If you want, I'll try to line you up an audition." And I said, "Sure, I'll sure."
That's awesome. Yeah.
So I just auditioned and got the gig.
And how long were you in that band?
Maybe about a year or two. For the one album, Force of the last Capitol Records album. So we went to England and recorded that album. And from the time I was in the band to the time the band got dropped, it was probably going on 2 years, something like that.
Wow.
Yeah, it was fun times. I'm playing in a band now with Exodus, the singer, an AC/DC cover band. We're playing.
Yeah, I saw that.
We're playing Hell's Angels. Gig at the Hell's Angels Clubhouse this Saturday, and they're expecting like 1,000 people there.
that's awesome.
So San Francisco is not open for business as far as having bands, but apparently the Hell's Angels are.
Yeah, who's gonna tell them otherwise?
Supposedly June 15th, Gavin Newsom, the governor of California, says everything fully wide open June 15th.
That's good.
We'll see. It has something. I'm sure it has something to do with him being recalled.
Yeah, I'm sure.
But if he opened everything, if everything opens up, that's great. We'll see.
Yeah. So would that be a good paying gig to play for the Hell's Angels?
I'm not expecting to make. You know, maybe I'll make $100 or something. I don't know. Yeah. Don't know. Okay. It's the standard pay for bands around here. You know, if you're in a decent band. Each person come home with $100 cash.
Yeah, we're lucky to make that, believe me. But yeah, obviously I don't do this for the money, but I was just curious if it was such a big event that you maybe, you know.
No, the singer's friends with the Hell's Angels guys, and he booked it. I don't know how long I'm going to be in this AC/DC band, because I don't think they're that happy with my bass playing. I don't know why. I thought I played AC/DC fucking great, but apparently, I don't know. But we'll see how it goes. I'm enjoying playing. I love playing AC/DC, and I love Zetra the singer, and Joel from the Butlers and Feather, which is also one of the guitar players, and the guy does a great Angus. And
that's awesome.
But I don't want to get into it too much. But the drummer and I are having a little bit of a problem grooving together, I guess you could say.
That's gonna be my next question. I don't know how to explain it, but like Phil Rudd is not necessarily easy to replicate, you know?
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah. He's not. A lot of people think that he is.
Yeah, it's such
but he's
bullshit,
not.
Man.
And I don't want to get into that because somebody may listen to the show.
I'm just saying in general though, I guess maybe because I am a drummer. Yeah. I'm a bit
people think
annoying.
That AC/DC songs are easy to play. If you're a drummer, forget just a drummer. They're not easy to play.
Yeah, no, I hear you, man. And what I think, and like I don't know, I can tell when I hear someone else playing it. You know, when Phil Rudd wasn't on those records, I mean, they still sounded good, but they didn't. I don't know what.
Not Phil
he does,
Rudd. There is nobody like Phil Rudd. Yeah, and there's nobody like Malcolm Young either.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I mean, that's a big part of it too. But I mean, I don't know the way Phil Rudd plays. He has this sort of like swing and a.
Yes.
And his snare is always a tiny bit behind.
He plays behind the beat. That's right. Yeah.
And
most drummers don't.
No matter how much I try, I can't. It's very hard to replicate. Yeah.
And you can't tell drummers if they can't play behind the beat, they can't play behind the beat. And so.
Yeah.
And. Yeah. I mean, I'm not really a behind the beat bass player, but I grew up with AC/DC. So I can play along. I'll sit here and play along to these songs. I've gone over this set fucking a million times. I can play them in my sleep now. And then I get to practice and I can't fucking play them. And it's not working out right. So for that reason, it's me and the drummer are not locking in somehow. So,
yeah.
And it's between the drummer, I mean, I'm willing to work with it, but I got a feeling that. They might not be as patient as me, but so we'll see what happens. I could be just paranoid and critical of myself. So we'll see what happens.
So what sort of deep cuts are you guys doing?
Oh shit. It's all deep cuts.
That's awesome. Like Kicked in the Teeth, Riff
Raff. Yeah. We do Riff Raff. Well, that's not what's on this set, but, this set is like Down Payment Blues.
Nice.
Night Prowler.
Oh wow!
What's cool. Next to the Moon? Walk All Over You. Touch Too Much.
I was going to ask you if you're going to do Walk All Over You. That and Beating Around the Bush to me are just two of their finest moments.
Jailbreak. It's all pretty much all deep cuts. There is no hit. They don't play Highway to Hell. Put it that way.
Okay, that's cool. That's good. That sounds like fun.
It's fun. It's fun if everybody's having a good time. And,
yeah.
And I'm not getting yelled at for hitting wrong notes.
Excuse
I don't play in cover bands to get yelled at.
Yeah. Do you find just real quick to get to playing covers too? And maybe I'm very reverent of stuff I really like. Like, and I hate to screw it up, you know?
Yeah.
And and in general, when people like the whole cover band thing, I find it such fascinating. I find it very hard to play like someone else. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I
grew up listening to AC/DC, so that's pretty much second nature. Even though these deep cuts I had to learn because I never played these deep cuts. So.
Yeah.
And when you have to learn 30 deep cuts, and the 30 deep cuts are very structurally very similar to each other. You can get the solo mixed up with a different solo and that.
Yeah.
So,
especially I find that especially when I'm cramming too. If I'd learn a bunch of songs, they all start running. So.
But we'll see how it goes. I'm looking forward to. Hopefully, I'll still be in the. If I'm still in the band after Saturday, then everything will be fine.
Yeah. Cool. Well, good luck.
Yeah. If I'm not, it's not the end of the world. Although I'll be bummed. I don't like getting kicked out of bands. So.
Yeah, I hear you. It's never fun. Another thing I wanted to say to you too, I, you know, I wanted to be on.
I lost you. We're breaking up.
Okay, I'm sorry. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. I won't tell you how much you know. I'm a big fan of the show, and I wanted if I wanted to be on. And you know, you turned me on a lot of cool stuff that I didn't know was out there, which is, you know, really, really cool. And I had to tell you, it probably blew me away the most was when you had on Mike Chapman. Because, you know, I obviously knew who he was and, you know, humongous Sweet fan. But, like, when I realized that he also produced the first Knack record and Parallel Lines, like, my head exploded. Like, oh, my God, there's this almost a straight line through all the stuff I like. And it's Mike Chapman, you know?
Yeah.
It was crazy.
He also did the vinyls. The guy, if I could have anybody to produce a record, it would be Mike Chapman or Jack Douglas, but probably be Mike Chapman first.
Yeah, I hear you. Yeah, and of course, you know, Susie, and I mean,
yeah, exactly.
And even Mud, you know, and like, you just tell his songs, you know, he's just, it blew me. And of course, so who else? Yeah, didn't he do the Nick Gilder record too?
Yes, he sure did. He wrote those songs.
Yeah, amazing.
Yeah, I really enjoyed talking to him. That's when I had a guy producing the show, and when podcasting was new. Back in those days, it was easier to get guests because podcasting was a new thing. Now everybody and his brother has a podcast. So
yeah, I'm sure. Absolutely.
But yeah, that was a good one.
All right, so what next?
I still want to talk about you before I get into. You sent me a bunch of songs. You sent me a bunch of songs, but we'll play some of the songs. But we're only 26 minutes into this. What do you do for a living?
Well, I am a colorist, and I work for NFL Films, which is I work in post production doing color correction and. Correction, color enhancement for the shows that we do that come out of our department.
NFL Films. Do you hear that, friends? Like I said before, I don't have schlubs on this show. All right. NFL Films, that's pretty impressive.
Well, thank you. I mean, it's you know, I feel pretty lucky to work there. It wasn't, my earbuds are falling out, and this is the first time I've ever used earbuds. Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm sorry. The wife gave me the earbuds. You should try these. They're actually pretty cool. I've been, you know, working in post-production my whole career. And, you know, NFL Films is a great place to work because obviously it's NFL Films and whatever. But also, you know, in the Philadelphia market, it's one of the few places like it. So to, you know, to get a job there, you kind of, I feel very lucky, almost like I hit the lottery. So
what does NFL Films produce? They don't do the NFL games, or do they?
No, we're NFL. We're there to do NFL Films type stuff, like all the highlights.
Okay. For ESPN or?
Whomever, really. Okay. All the sort of slow-mo,
right?
You know, tight spirals, that long lens stuff, that's us. And we shoot every game with multiple cameras just to be used for our own the highlights and then to be licensed and all to other people and also to be used in our own content because we do a bunch of highlight shows as well. So, and then we also do documentaries. We do a lot of stuff for the network. We do stuff for HBO, you know, but it's 99% of it's all football. When I first started, we used to do a little bit of outside work, you know, stuff that wasn't football oriented.
So the colorist, what do you, you make sure the color looks a certain way or?
Yeah, I mean, the way I describe it to other musicians is it's sort of like visual mastering, right? So, right, because the record's recorded over different days, different studios, right? You master it and you make it better, you make it cohesive, right? That's what a colorist does.
So you have to make it look like the color of their other shows?
Depending on the show, some of it's really creative. Like, you know, I sort of say that we're an extension to the camera department because they shoot it and then we take it and then we mold it into what they wanted, or we could do more to it. You know, we can highly stylize stuff. Like, for instance, I don't know anything about the Marvel Universe movie, so I apologize to anyone who's a fan of this, but They just re-released one of the movies. Zack Snyder, I guess, directed one, and they did it before, and then they redid it for HBO or something. But I don't know if you've seen anything like the. Both of his movies are color corrected completely different. So differently. So, you know, you can stylize and almost relight stuff in post, you know, kind of like Photoshop, I guess.
Right. Okay.
Kinda, mm-hmm. Yeah. That makes sense.
And that pays pretty well.
It's fine.
How many people are in your office?
Oh, well, NFL Films is pretty big. I mean, it depends. It could be anywhere between 250 to like three or, you know, three to 500 people, depending on the day and the time of the year. Busy. We actually have studios, so we do production. We do post. We have a humongous audio department. And, you know, from shooting to pretty much distribution, this can all be done in our building. So.
All right, I'm going to pause it here, Rob, because I'm going to try to get a different Wi-Fi connection. So hold on just a second, okay? Okay, all right. Yeah. All right, we're back. Okay. So you sent me a bunch of tunes, so I figured you sent me the tunes. Now, this is because you're the co-host. This is actually your show, and I've taken over your show, and I apologize for that.
No, it's fine. Like I said, I just wanted to chat with you because I'm a big fan.
Well, feel free if you have anything to comment to, because I don't know if you listened to the last co-host show, but I had Chris Capel on.
Yeah, that was the inspiration for me actually doing it. I mean,
if you want to go into your sexual exploits too, you're more than welcome to.
I imagine that'd be pretty boring for most people.
You're married?
yes, I am. Yeah, I'm married. Like I said, my wife is a bass player. She's we were in a band together back in the early 90s.
How long you been married?
20 years.
Oh, 20. Okay. But I've got 31.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah.
Mm. Got kids?
Yeah. I have one 18 year old.
Oh, that's right.
Son.
You told me that already.
Yeah. He's a big, real big, really big, really into music.
What's his favorite band?
It's funny you say, I would say at this moment, Caius, he loves like stoner and doom that of stuff of that nature.
Did you turn him on to Black Flag?
Yeah, he likes that. You know, he kind of floats around. Like his first real love though was Sabbath, and then
you should play him side two of Black Flag, My War, and see what he thinks of that.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, that's a pretty heavy album. That's funny. I didn't think about that.
Because that album influenced all those guys. Influenced Caius, influenced the Queens of the Stone, influenced all those stoner guys.
Yeah,
that album.
Yeah, like that, like, you know, Electric Wizard. Of course, he likes all, you know, Metallica, right. All the sort of 80s, you know, the new, what do you call it, the new wave of British heavy metal.
Right.
Likes all that, most of that stuff. You know, obviously, he's a big Steve Harris fan. And that's kind of his vibe. So, but, you know, he it's funny because he does occasionally record dance music too. So, but he's mostly, you know, a long hair headbanger.
Uh-huh. Well, good.
Yeah. I feel he goes to a local school of rock here, and they're franchised. So
right,
they're a little a little different. But I have to say, like where he goes is amazing. Like they're really great guys and girls, and you know they besides being super cool, like they still fly the rock flag pretty hard. You know, they do a lot of shows, you know, they always have themed shows and they're, you know, there's always some sort of hard rock and they do a Queen show or they'll do an Ozzy versus Dio show or, you know,
do they give them any instruction on how to look cool on stage?
Oh yeah. They they tell them to make sure, you know, when they do shows, how not to, you know, not to stand there and make sure you dress for it. And, you know, and being our son, we give them, you know, we make sure that no one's staring at their, you know, no one's shoegaze. Like, I don't allow him to shoegaze on stage. Yeah, I mean, he doesn't anymore at all. I mean, his band is particular, you know, when they played, they were very, very animated, and they really got into it. It was awesome.
If my son was playing guitar, I would tell him, when you're in your room, I'd put a big mirror on his wall, and I'd say, you're in your room, don't worry about shaking the house, jump around in front of that mirror. That's what I used to do when I was a kid. My mom would bang on the door, what the hell's going on in there? The whole house is shaking. Nothing. I'm just sitting here listening to me, and I'm jumping all up, bouncing off the walls. And
yeah, man. So we used to, like, it's funny because he got into that pretty quickly, the really understanding how, you know, no one wants to see someone staring at their hands, you know. And they promote that where he goes. Like, so I feel lucky. They're a really good group of people, and they expose them to a lot of really good stuff. I mean, new stuff as well.
Good. So they're still doing it during the pandemic.
Yeah, it's a little weird. You know, of course they were doing they do shows every quarter, themed shows. So they would do lessons online, and then when they rehearsed for the show, they were doing it online. And now they're back in person, but the shows were. The last couple shows that they did, they have a really nice space too. I don't know if all school rocks have this, but they have a really big room with a nice stage with great PA, you know, well-maintained instruments, good amps. So they would, when they did their last two shows, they did them, you know, over the internet, but I think they're going to start, I think the next one I guess it's in June, they may actually start letting people back in. So. Which we're obviously looking forward to, you know, because obviously the first time they did it, they had some issues with the sound coming over the internet. The second time that they rectified that, and it sounded much better. But
well, that's good. You got a son who's into playing rock and roll. That's good.
Yeah. It's been it's fun. I mean, it just blows my mind too, because he started so young, and like, you know, just like watching him progress, and it's, you know, obviously I can relate to it. So, and we didn't, you know, I didn't force them or anything. You know, I was a bit worried actually for a while. Like, he didn't really care about music. And then I think once he turned 12, a light switch went off.
You said he plays bass?
Yeah. He's primarily a bass player. Yeah.
And what's his bass? What's his bass of choice?
Well, he used the P. He's got a 5-string.
Uh-huh. Because he dropped tunes.
Yeah, you know, which... I'm trying to be, I'm sort of embarrassed as his dad. No, I'm kidding.
Well, but, if he's into Caius, that's why he's.
He's got I bought him a cheap, like an 80s Iceman. He has that bass. And then he really wanted this 70s Rickenbacker knockoff, Hondo.
He's a Cliff fan.
Yeah, that too. Yeah. Plus, you know, so, I mean, all kinds of, like, he's got a SVT.
He's got
it's a transistor one, but my wife has it. I got my wife an Orange Terror bass head.
I have one of those.
Yeah, it sounds really good. It's a Sans amp she uses. And, he's got a lot of shit at his disposal. He's, of course, he got when he first got the Ampeg, he got a 410 SRW. It's really, kind of 80s sounding.
You need an Ampeg 410 with the big fat Ampeg 410 or an 810.
So I think that's it. I mean, we got a handful of guitars and stuff, but I have an old, it was actually my wife's, an old Kappa. You remember that brand Kappa? They made like surf guitars back in the.
I think so.
We have one. He has that, and he bought like an old, God, this is probably so boring, you're even listening. Just bought an old Strat knockoff and been rewiring it.
Right. We've gone almost 40 minutes with no music. I apologize, friends. So you sent me a shitload of songs, 17 songs.
We don't play all of it.
What did you want to play first?
I thought I kind of numbered them. I think we should go with the Lime Spiders. I don't know if you're familiar with them, but this song, Out of Control, is one of my all-time favorite singles. They're a band out of Australia from the mid-80s that we're really big, I'm a really big fan of, and they had a big influence on me. And I just think the song can just flat out rocks. So curious to think what you think. Hear what you think.
Here is Lyme Spiders Out of Control. Yeah.
I was just going to run to the bathroom.
Oh, yeah, go ahead. I'm all right. The music's playing, so I... All right. Rob went to the bathroom, friends. Go Lime Spiders, you there, Rob?
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah, you hear me?
Yeah. You know the Goo Goo Dolls?
Yeah, they covered Slave Girl, I think.
That's right.
They?
Yes, they did. I'll play a little bit of Slave Girl here. Lime Spot. Not the whole song, just play a couple. Okay, there you go. Goo Goo Dolls.
Yeah, it was funny. I was in the car one morning, it was sort of 20 some years ago, and had the radio on Sunday morning, and that came on. I'm like, flipping out, like, who is this? Like, on the commercial radio here in the line. And oh wait, it's a cover. Yeah, so that's cool. You like those guys?
Yeah, it's good. I'm not that familiar with them. I know of the band, but I love Australian rock and roll, but I'm not. The only punk rock bands, Australian punk rock bands, is the Weirdos from not the Weirdos. What the fuck are they called?
The Hard-Ons. The
Hard-Ons, that's what I'm talking about. Yeah. Hard-Ons, yeah.
Yeah, I almost put a Hard-On song on here, but I sort of forgot. Obviously, I had more than enough, so I didn't want to add any more.
And,
of course,
I love the Angels, and I love Rose Tattoo. And
Absolutely. I always say, we always joke that there's something in the water in Australia, man. There's just, like some of the best rock and roll in the world comes out of there.
Yeah.
And still does. I mean, even Airborne, I know they're
I like Airborne too.
Yeah, they're just like, holy smokes, these guys just I actually saw the Lyme Spiders in the 80s. They were really good. Do you remember the Salvat Rifles, also a great Australian. Yeah, saw those guys back in the day. And the Die Pretty, another one of my all-time favorite bands. A little bit more moody, but really good, very original sounding. They put out some really great records.
And of course, Rick Springfield is.
Yeah, absolutely.
Great Australian import.
Yeah, I guess if we, I feel kind of terrible that I put a Bay City Roller song on here.
I know, the bass singer died.
Yeah, I hope I didn't jinx him. I apologize.
Yeah, it's your fault. When I was in American Heartbreak, the original drummer for American Heartbreak played with the Bay City Rollers for a West Coast tour a long time ago.
Wow, that's
awesome.
And
one of the guys in the band, I think his name was Ian. I don't know all the guys by name.
Yeah, me neither.
He got up and played with American Heartbreak. We did S-A-T-U-R song. And we did Yesterday's Heroes. Is that a Bay City Roller song?
Yeah, that's a great song.
We did those two songs with that guy from Bay City Rollers. Not with the singer, but with the guitar player.
Yeah, they had a lot of really good songs. You know, and obviously, being in a Cream Circus, I'm a huge fan of that, early 70s British or glam. And they did it pretty well. I was gonna put on this list. It was a toss up between Money Honey and Yesterday's Heroes.
You want to play Money Honey now for
the
what's the guy's name that died?
Les something or other. I apologize.
Yeah, rest in peace, singer for Bay City Rollers. Was he the last remaining? The guy who played with us, I think he died several few years ago.
Yeah, I don't know if he's the last remaining, but I know some died, and I know he toured, but I think he was the only original member. So, this was their. I actually had this single, at least to me. I remember this was the single that they, at least I remember hearing on the radio after Saturday Night. It's called.
Did you see them on? Could remember when Howard Cosell had the TV show Saturday Night Live? Do you remember that show?
No.
Yeah, before the TV show Saturday Night Live, the comedy show or whatever, the skit show, Howard Cosell had a Saturday Night TV show called Saturday Night Live, and the first episode, I'm pretty sure the very first episode, the Bay City Rollers were on, and he debuted them in the United States.
That's awesome.
I saw that episode when I was a kid. I remember it distinctly.
And were you into it?
Yeah, it was cool.
Yeah.
Then it was a hit like right after. And then, of course, they were in a circus and all that after that.
Yeah, cool.
All right, here's Money Honey by Bay City Roll. Rest in peace, the guy from
Les
Bay City Roll.
Yeah, Les McCown or something? Yeah. Something like
yes.
that. Yeah.
Rest in peace, Les. Okay.
Yeah. just to see what you can get.
There you go, Bay City Rollers. You hear the dual guitar solos.
Yeah, it's a great song. Love that song. Can't remember what the flip side of that was. I wish I still had. I still somewhere have the single for Saturday Night. The 45, yeah. And when my son was little, we used to listen to records on this little Mickey Mouse turntable that I had. Well. It was like the what I had when I was a kid. It sounded like, it really sounds awful.
Yeah, I don't know if those guys wrote their own tunes or not. I don't know enough about
it. Yeah, I think actually that one, I looked it up on Wikipedia yesterday when I was getting these together, and I think they were credited with that one. But, you know, I think the big hits were written by songwriting team.
Right. Maybe it was Boyce and Hart. Probably not.
It's funny, I was going to put a Boyce and Hart song on here, too.
Huh, which Boyce and Hart? Because they wrote for, who'd they write for? Paul Revere and the Raiders? And
I think they wrote Stepping Stone, which was originally a Paul Revere song. Yeah. Before
Sex Pistols.
Monkees.
They wrote a lot of Monkees tunes, I think.
Too. Yeah, I think they wrote Last Train to Clarksville, too. Is that them?
Yeah, they were on Bewitched, an episode of Bewitched.
Yeah. I was one of the songs I was going to put on here because I like that one a real lot. And of course, the first time I ever heard it was, a humongous Red Cross fan was on Teen Babes from Monsanto. And, I didn't know, it's funny, I didn't know half of those songs were even covered. of course, I knew the Kiss song. And, so they do a cover. Well, you Kiss in the Wind, right? That's the one that they do on Bewitched, right?
That's right. I'm gonna blow you a kiss in the wind.
Yeah.
And that was when Sabrina's or Samantha's cousin Sabrina.
Yeah, she's there. Yeah.
Yeah, she was like blowing kisses while they were playing.
Yeah.
I watched that show when it was still on. So that's how old I am, but.
I'm only a few years younger than you, but I watched it. I think it was in reruns. I don't remember seeing it first run, but yeah, I remember that. Yeah, those guys were great. And I mean, of course, I Wonder What She's Doing Tonight, too. It's just such a, man, talk about a catchy song. My goodness. A real quick Red Cross story was Beretta 76, my other project, we played with the Muffs.
With the Muffs.
And I would say it was, Christ, I'm trying to remember the year, probably 08 or 09. And they flew in to the East Coast, from the West Coast, with no gear, for, I guess, guitars. And they played three gigs. They played with us in Philly. I guess we were like Saturday night, and they played the night before. And then I think they were going to Maxwell's, and I think they had their three or four gigs. So anyway, they show up and they used all our gear and they were super nice. They're really nice guys. And I didn't realize that Roy McDonald was playing with him and he was in Red Cross. So of course I was like super ultra fanboy at that point. Like, oh my God, Roy, he's playing my drums. And I used my drums, but they were really good. But what's really funny about that night was they used all our gear. And then halfway through the set, their bass even broke, their actual bass guitar broke, so they used our bass too. So the only thing they really had theirs was our guitar, and they thoroughly and utterly kicked our ass. And which they're an amazing band, of course, but it was like talk about like not only getting smoked by another band, but getting smoked by another band using your own gear is kind of it's very humbling.
I was in love with Kim Shattuck. She was a great talent.
No, they were super. Like they were just really down to earth. Ronnie was sort of quiet, but you know, talking with Roy and with Kim, she was just really just kind of sweet and easygoing, and they were great. They were great. I mean, like when, I said, they came in. You know,
when Kim died, I did a tribute show.
Yes, I heard it. Very good.
And I got a Facebook message like 2 days later from that that Ronnie guy. Yeah. That was her boyfriend or husband or whatever. A very complimentary. Message from that guy.
No, that was a good show. She was sad. They're a great band.
Did you like the Pandoras?
I love, once again, all that 60s, the 80s 60s revival was really very influential. Yeah.
I like the hard rock version of the Pandoras, and she hated it, but I love that album, that rock hard album they did.
You know, I don't know if I'm familiar with that. I just remember hearing their songs like on college radio back in the day. And then, you know, of course, that all the stuff that followed, you know, like all the stuff that were around, I guess the Paisley Underground, the 3 o'clock, all that. I loved all that stuff. Yeah,
they did an album like it was like a Motley Crue type album.
Oh, yeah, I got to check that out. Yeah.
There's some great tunes on that album.
great band.
All right. So what's the next song we're going to play?
I don't know. Maybe we should.
Unless you don't want to play songs, you can talk.
No. I don't. Yeah,
it's your show.
I feel like I'm floundering. I feel terrible for the rest of the fans.
You're doing great. There's no fans. They're all friends of the show, so they can no longer.
Let me just say this way. Like I feel like I said, I had to follow that Frank Meyer guy and you know Keith Morrison and Cindy Quattro. So and I'm like I'm really gonna suck. But then you have to remind myself I'm paying to be on the show.
That's
so there's
right.
A reason why. Yeah. There's a reason I'm paying because I'm not.
By the way, friends. You too can be a guest on the Rock and Roll, or you can host the Rock and Roll Geek Show. Just go to rockandrollgeek.com and hit the donate link, and for the very short time of $100, because I'm gonna be getting ready to raise the price, I think. So get it while it's hot, friends. And by the way, the Patreon donors, you don't get charged for the co-host. So if you think I'm double dipping, I'm not.
Yeah,
so this episode is funded exclusively by Rob Giglio.
Very good. All right, how about we listen to the Quick song, No No Girl?
Okay, all right, the Quick.
You familiar with these guys?
Yes, I am. I think my friend Joe Klein had something to do with the Quick.
Well, once again, another band that, you know, just sort of discovered not that long ago. And, of course, I didn't realize Pretty Please Me was a cover until I heard Red Cross do it, because I knew it from the Dickies, and I come to find out, you know, originally it was a Quick song. But anyway, I think this record, this whole record is really good, and it's a really good sounding record too. I don't know,
the Quick is good. Are they affiliated at all with? No, I don't think they're affiliated with Kim Fowley at all.
Who knows? I don't, like I said, I know nothing, very little about them other than, like I said, finding them via the Dickies, via Red Cross, you know? Yeah. And
you were a Dickies fan?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, my old punk rock band, Stevie Saletta, we were highly influenced by the Dickies.
Yeah, I loved, that's funny, one of my closest friends, actually, he lives around the corner from me now, too, but we went to high school together, we lived together, huge, huge record collector, and he actually had the 10-inch white vinyl. I forget what that it was like a maxi single, and it had You Drive Me Ape and had Paranoid on there. That was my John at that time. That was such a great record.
I
saw them.
I think they're still going.
Yeah, I've seen them twice. But very entertaining live. Pretty much the same set, same shtick, but they were a lot of fun. Great band.
Anyway, we're digressing. Here's the Quick.
Yeah, there we go.
The song's called No No Girl?
Yeah, I think so.
All right. No No Girl from the Quick.
Mommy! They leave you alone with your toys on the floor. You've been so good and they don't even see. If you were bad, you'd be on daddy's knee. Little girl lost who was often ignored. Grew into a teenager frequently bored. Found out the bad things most often feel good. And then tried as many of them as she could. But nobody cares. She tries to be dangerous, but no one's aware. She is still after her lost relation. A classic case of father fixation. Daddy was good. Daddy was just. Daddy was God. In dad you could trust. So when you were bad, he knew what to do. But now there is no one who cares about you.
That's a great tune. I was right. The keyboard player went on to write tunes with Kim Fowley. I knew there was a connection.
Yeah. How many records did they even put out?
I'm on their Wikipedia. They did Mondo Deco, Untold Rock Stories, and then couple of singles. I think I have some quick music. Let me look and see what I got here quick.
It just always amazes me, like...
Oh, I just have Mondo Deco. I only have what you sent me, okay.
Yeah, that whole record's really, really good. Why didn't I hear that as a kid growing up? Like, why wasn't that in the mix with the Cars? And, you know, I don't know. It's just so good. And it's just amazing all this stuff we didn't hear because of, you know, radio only was so very limited. Yep. Kind of bums me out.
That's the fun. Yeah. It's part of the fun of... deep diving into rock and roll.
Yeah, no, really. And like when I sort of rediscovered the Sweet in the 90s, this videotape I bought, I was just like blown away. It's called Glam Rock, and it was like all BBC videos, right? So right. I think Alice Cooper was on there, but the rest of it was just like, you know, them lips, you know, so it was like four or five Sweet songs, four or five Slade songs. I think Susie was on there. It was like a bunch of Gary Glitter songs, which were fucking amazing. Uh-huh. And I'm like, I was so like, wow, I cannot believe I never heard half of this stuff, yeah. You know? And like, especially being a big Kiss fan, when I really heard Slade, I was like, oh, my. So this is what Kiss is kind of trying to do, you know? I don't know if they were, I don't know who came out first, but, you know, anyway, so it's just funny, like, I was actually angry that
I like that quick tune. I'm gonna have to search out some more quick albums.
Yeah, it's really well recorded too. They sound like sparse, but it's a little bit more rocking, and I don't know.
It was a little like Nick Gilder a little bit.
Yeah, definitely the range of the voice, and they do a lot of that, like And that, there's another one. They do a cover of the Beatles, It Won't Be Long Now, and it's really good. And they do a lot of that where they like kind of break into like little Baroque kind of things, you know, like they do in Spinal Tap and Listen to the Flower People. They do one of those breaks. You know, I don't know. I just love that shit. It's really funny. So should we rock in another one here?
It's up to you. It's your show, friend.
All right. Let's do it. I don't know. Can you play the Teen Generate song?
Okay, let me look for Teen Generate. Okay, Radio 55.
Yeah, Japanese punk band, 90s.
My
really
friend
good.
Jasper used to co-host Mad at Dad, or not Mad at Dad, co-host Good Clean Fun with me. He was a big Teen Generate guy.
Yeah, once again, just like, they play like their hair's on fire, and they have like walking bass lines too. It's like punk rock, but with like these, you know, I don't know, they're just amazing. And plus this record's recorded like, you'll hear it.
All right, here's Radio 55 from Teen Generate. Teen Generate. We called that lo-fi. That super distorted, like a Guitar Wolf is also
It was funny. I was going to mention because I saw Guitar Wolf one time and was like blown away. just insane. Actually, that was a crazy show. I'm pretty sure that was. I think I saw them with the John Spencer Blues Explosion and the
noisy
Fall.
Band.
Yeah, and the Fall.
Your ears would be hurting at the end of that night.
but Guitar Wolf were just amazing.
I would leave that place really stressed out, probably.
noise. Funny, now, and you know what? Like, I kind of like some of the Fall, but like sitting through a whole show of that was not a lot of fun.
Although it could have been very, as they say, cathartic too. Who knows?
Yeah, no, some people really love that. They're just so repetitive, but it's just, I don't know, like,
it's not the repetition. The songs are good. It's the distortion and loudness. Ears are bleeding.
Yeah. Yeah. It's funny that, do you do this? I mean, you have confused gigs. Like, I think that may have been two separate gigs because they were at the same venue and I'm putting them together, but I don't know. But anyway.
Yeah, all the time.
All right. So maybe why don't we play... let me play the Shivers, Teen Line.
Okay. Let me see.
I know a ton about these band guys. I guess 80s power pop that, once again, just recently discovered and was like blown away how great, what a great song.
I don't know anything about the Shivers. The album is called Lost Hits from Milwaukee's first family of power pop, 79 to 82. All right. I'll look. See if I can find any fun facts about the Shivers while the song's playing. Teen Line. You don't know anything about them?
No.
How'd you find them?
You know, I don't know. Who knows? sometimes, like, I do you remember, like, I guess in around the early 2000s, like, everyone had blogs.
Well, every morning I get up and I look at blogs. There's several music blogs, and I will look at every morning. And that's how I discover a lot of there's one blog I go to. It's called Power Pop Overdose.
Yes, I haven't been there in a while, but absolutely, yeah.
I discover a lot of music from that.
Yeah, and there was this one guy I used to follow. It was called Scar Stuff, and I think he made it. Well, anyway, point being, one of these blogs back then in the early 2000s, a lot of the stuff I discovered from that, and the Shivers, I think, made one of those bands. So.
And the good blogs of those would also post a link to where you can not download the album, because that would just be wrong.
Exactly. That's how. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. It's funny because I had to sort of find some of the stuff because I didn't have it readily handy. As a matter of fact, I wanted the Teen Generate song I wanted to send was called My GTO. Have you ever heard that?
That's their
amazing.
That's their hit, as they say.
Yeah. But I couldn't find it. It's funny, I couldn't find it legally, and I didn't know where it was on my stack of hard drives. So anyway,
all right, and it's pronounced, it's spelled with two V's, like, instead, you know, not like you're shivering, right. You know what a shiv is, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's what they are, the Shivers. All right, get it? Okay, here's Teen Line, the Shivers.
Cause my heart's on the teen line. All you do is call in the sun.
All right, I'll have to look for that too because I like that. It was catchy.
And it's pretty good. Huh? I mean, it was. I think what's interesting about that song is, you know, it's very light and shiny, but that woman's vocals are so, I don't know, they're so good, yeah. And they're her delivery is so desperate. Like it really, I don't know if that sounds corny, but like it really sells the song. Like I don't know, kind of, yeah. It really, I think it's pretty amazing.
I will have to look for more. If any friends out there, if you have the Shivers album with two V's, please don't send me that, please.
Yeah, please don't. Let us know.
Some people may have bailed because it's all power pop, but I like the power pop stuff. It's the hour of power pop. That's, we're kind of doing an hour and a half of power pop here, so I like that.
Oh, good. I hope everyone, some other people.
I like the power pop. If they don't, that's okay. They can always skip it and go listen to Matt, what's his name? Mitch LaFon.
Was Eddie Trunk, I guess.
Yeah, whoever. Decibel Geek.
I think you and I have a very similar opinion of him.
Of Eddie Trunk? I'm jealous of Eddie Trunk. That's my opinion of him. I'm jealous. I wish I had his job.
Yeah. No,
He deserves all of his success. He repeats himself and he name drops and he talks about texting everybody and he knows everybody and he's real important. But that being said, he's got a great job and I am extremely jealous of him. And everything is out of jealousy.
Yeah. Now I feel the same way, but I have to say the name dropping I find gets a little grating.
But I do listen to his show. Unless he has John 5 on, or unless he has the same gang of guests.
Don't diss John 5. He was married to Aria Giovanni, so he's got. And who she is? She's a pinup model.
Yes, I know who she is. I actually have her doing an ID for the Rock and Roll Geek
Show.
Really?
Oh my God! I'm even a bigger fan of you now than that.
I auditioned for Ozzy Osbourne and Ozzy was not there, but Sharon Osbourne was there. The drummer Randy Castillo was there and a nerdy guitar player named John was there and that's John 5.
Wow.
So I auditioned for Ozzy and it was John 5 and Randy Castillo and needless to say, I didn't get the gig, but
Fun? Was it exciting? Was it scary?
Scary as shit. But especially when especially when Randy Castillo played the songs different than the record, and I fucked him up.
Oh yeah.
Oof. But you know, I tried. Yeah. But anyway, why I was just dropping John 5's name because he was there at the audition. He and Randy Castillo had a band called Red Square Black, I believe. I could be wrong on that, but I'm pretty sure they did. And when I went to audition, I was told by Ozzy's manager, go into the rehearsal hall and tell the guy at the front desk that you're looking for the room for Red Square Black. And that's how I knew I was, the guy played his guitar like up to his like a necklace, and he was real nerdy. He didn't have long hair at the time, and he didn't he didn't paint his face. Aria Giovanni she only did like girl stuff, I think. Unfortunately, I don't have her ID with me because that's on a different hard drive. But yeah. She was at a comic book convention. This is back when the comic book conventions had softcore porn stars do signs. And I got her to. I walked up to her and I said, "Boy, you sure are ugly."
That's awesome because how many people tell her she's beautiful, right? Like that, you definitely made an impression.
She laughed. She laughed.
Yeah, that's good. Was she really beautiful in person?
Yeah, she was hot.
Yeah, she's quite lovely. Quite lovely lady.
Yeah, she was in Penthouse magazine quite a few times. I think I had a few of those. I won't get into
I know, it's funny. I used to have an intern, and he his last day, he bought me it wasn't a Penthouse, but it was some magazine where she was on the it was some fetish magazine that she was on the cover. That was his going away. That was his going away present to me because he knew I was a fan. I know it's funny. He was a really not only was he a great guy, but he showed up his, I think the first day he showed up for his interview to intern with me, he had a T-Rex t-shirt on. So, I mean, he knew how to dress to impress. Let's put it that way.
Have you seen her lately? Have you seen pictures of her lately? I just now pulled up her picture.
She still look good?
Well, this one picture might not. Well, yeah, she still looks good. Yeah. She's a little older looking, but getting a little bit. Yeah, she's good looking. She's an Italian chick. Yeah, hot Italian chick. She's got. She's not as good looking as she used to be, but she still doesn't look bad. She's bangable, as they say.
Well, she definitely had a couple of phases where, like, where she was really kind of thin too, right? And then later on, she wasn't as thin.
She get a boob job.
I don't know. That's always
she had big boobs.
Questionable.
So he's not with her anymore?
I don't think so. No.
I wonder why she dumped him.
But I just remember that about him. Because I don't think I even knew who he was. And I found out, I was sort of a fan, and she was married to him. And I was like, who's John? Oh, okay, that guy. You know, so.
I will Google the two of them. Here's a picture of them together. Oh yeah, she doesn't look happy. He looks like a douche.
He's got to be doing something right, man. That's why, I always say that. You know, I'm a huge fan of.
She had a boob job. She got when she's with him. Picture all the pictures. Well, when the picture I'm looking at her and him. Her boobs are like a triple E, and when I saw her, she didn't have triple E boobs.
Yeah,
look at him, man. He's got like that goofy looking beard.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of that whole whatever that new metal aesthetic that was.
Fuck
haircut
that guy.
And all that.
Fuck that guy.
That's hilarious. All right, so
Here's a picture of them behind backstage. Yeah, neither of them look happy when they're sitting there together. They look like they just got into a fight, and he's wearing a stupid face paint. He got his face paint from Zal Clemenson. Zal Clemenson was in the Sensational Alex Harvey band.
Oh yes.
Yeah, I'm sure he's a great guitar player, but fuck that guy.
should we get back to some rock?
Okay.
Hey, so what's the beer situation there out in,
I'm on my second Modelo. I'm almost finished with it. I'm gonna have to, while this song's playing, I'm gonna have to go use the bathroom, otherwise I'm gonna have to use a cup.
All right, good. So we'll definitely play a
song. My number two, I'll be on number three real soon.
Good to hear. Why don't we play the Iron Version, Teenage Love Affair, which is actually, I think it is a cover of a Rick Derringer song, but I don't know. This is another obscure band I found, put out a couple singles.
Rick Derringer version?
I like that version, but I think I heard this one first and I was just blown away by it. I don't know. It's not that different. I don't know.
I love the Rick Derringer version. So
it's a great, the guy can write a great song. So
that Derringer live album is a great album, by the way.
Yeah. All right, we'll go put it on so you can go. I don't want you going in the cup.
Okay, here we go. Here we go!
I thought you noticed me when I saw her. She seemed to check me out right away. Saw after name, I'll play the old game. Her reception seemed to be okay. She was a cute little thing about 16, and she liked to make the school boys stare. It was an instant cosmic need, a teenage love affair. It was getting on a minute by minute, and she second brought her closer to me. And then we finally touched, and we touched and we touched, and her hands felt their way over me. So we made love. Daytime, when our mama left, we went upstairs. It was a total cosmic deal, teenage love affair. Teenage love affair, teenage love affair. Teenage love affair, teenage love affair. Teenage love affair. Teenage love affair.
There you go. Iron Virgin. Pardon me, I'm burping up this fine Modelo as I'm saying Virgin. Yeah, that's a great tune. From Scotland, I think Alex Harvey Band was from Scotland, too.
Yeah, they had their original was called Rebels Rule. Very, like, you know, glammy, good stuff. Didn't even know that was a cover, and then I discovered it was, but I just fell in love with that song. So great, so catchy. Well, we're like an hour and a half. Should we wrap it up? I don't want to, like...
You want to go another 15 minutes?
No, that's fine. I'm good to go. I just don't want to, you know, punish your listeners.
We'll go 15 more minutes. I may post this tonight. I may wait till tomorrow and post it tomorrow so I can... Because I got to paste the two episodes together. At the very latest, it'll be up tomorrow night, unless I die in a car crash or something.
Yeah. Well, don't do that. When I have Chandler, I want someone to, you know, thank you because you've, you know, besides being a fan of the show, you've, you know, played Cream Circus a couple of times and I really appreciate it. And you played a Beretta song too once, which was
I don't remember. I appreciate the support for all this time. Thank you for donating to the show too.
My pleasure. You know, I'm glad to give back and after a really tough year, not only because of the pandemic, but a bunch of other personal shit. Just a couple deaths in the family, that kind of thing. I just felt like wanted to give back to, like, you know, just let everyone know, you know.
Well, I appreciate it.
Glad to do it. Thanks for having me.
Has Cream Circus rehearsed lately?
De Pinto and I, Chris, I have a lot of Chris's in my life, so I just call him De Pinto. But him and I have gotten together periodically here, just him and I, and we've sent demos around. We've also did a couple of like things where we recorded videos of, we did three videos where we each recorded ourselves on cell phones and we married them. But as a full-blown rehearsal, no, the four of us have not been in the same room together.
For over since a our year.
Our last gig, I think, was February. We played live on the college radio, maybe a little after that. But the last gig was at the Creep Record Store for, like, our vinyl release party. And I think that was, like, the first weekend in February, and that was the last live gig. And I got to tell you, I mean, I'm sure you feel the same way, but I've had withdrawal. I really miss it. I just miss hanging out with the band.
Yeah, that's right. That's the best part of it. Yeah. Hanging out with your friends.
And as much as I love performing, it's great, but I enjoy practicing too. I know a lot of people don't, but I love being together, get together and it's a good release. And then of course you're going through all this, dealing with all this shit, you know, with the pandemic and everything. And you want, you know, you need a release and you don't have it, you know, it's like, it's so, it's really been very frustrating.
Yeah.
Another interesting story. Hopefully it's interesting, but we've been recording over this past year and, Chris and I have been going in the studio and, so we started right where the pandemic started, but we got 10 songs done. Uh-huh. And, I shouldn't say we got all the drum tracks out for 10 songs. And of course, they were digitally lost. I don't know if that's happened to anyone else.
Into a studio and the studio engineer, or you guys recorded at your home studio?
No. Creep Records, which is a label that does, you know, that we're on, quote unquote. They own a couple record stores. They have a small label, and they have their own studio. And they're, you know, Eric's a great guy there and everything, but unfortunately there was a malfunction and poof.
Hard drive crashed and lost it all. So he's going to give you guys, he owes you guys studio time then.
Yeah, well, he, you know, because we're on the label and it's his studio, we don't really, you know. Really
and because of him, time. You would have had, you guys, you could have laid the drum tracks down, everybody else could have done their tracks at home, and you'd have an album coming out.
Yeah, it was... it's funny how...
Did you guys bust his balls?
Not too badly, you know, but I have to say, like, it was a kick in the stomach. Let me, you know, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Your listeners, you know, I'm sure a lot of them are in bands or musicians. You know, I don't know if it's ever happened to you.
Well, that's why Joe Klein and I aren't speaking right now because.
Yes, I apologize. Yes, I'm very familiar with that story.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, believe me, because I work with digital files all the time too. I mean, I know shit happens, and you know, even at the level even at a big company that I work for, you know, we've had stuff get corrupted. It just happens, and so you can't. I don't want to point the finger, but it just. I'll tell you, man, I was really upset.
The lesson is backup recording.
Well, you've been in there since, and I did buy a hard drive. We're trying to get,
Have you re-recorded all the drum tracks?
No. We did three songs, and we did all songs that weren't done yet. And we're probably going to redo 8 or 9 of those 10.
And of course, your performances on those original tracks were way superior, right?
Yeah. I know, of course. You know, I don't know about you, but I stress when I go in the studio. So as much as I love the final outcome, you know, I don't do this professionally. So, you know, I don't have a ton of experience, but I find it a bit stressful. Yeah. And so when I had all those 10 tracks done, I felt, you know, a sense of relief because, okay, my part's done. And, then you know, they get to start all over. Yeah. So do you enjoy recording or how do you?
I don't love it. I like singing in the studio, but laying down bass tracks, I don't, unless I know the songs backwards, forwards, and sideways, and I'm there with the drummer tracking at the same time as the drummer. I'm okay with it, but when I have to sit down in the control room and just do the bass parts, I get a little bit stressed out about it. But
it's like being under a microscope, you know.
Yeah. I just went in. Mm-hmm. Last time I went in was for this JJ Savage kid, and it wasn't so bad. It was fairly stress free, I guess you can say.
Is it a local studio in San Francisco?
Yeah, it was like a metal guy. It was like in his house.
Yeah.
Cool. But you know, I prefer playing live. I like the finished product. Yeah. And I like laying down. I like singing in the studio, but I'm not that. I'll never be a session bass player. Let's put it that way. I'm not good enough.
Yeah. Do you ever find that interesting when people use the term studio hack? Like,
that's me. You know what I mean? Like, I'm a studio hack.
But people refer to people who, like, you know, session musicians, like, you know, there's these like brilliant musicians, you know, of course, like the Wrecking Crew and so on and so forth. And these guys are not hacks by any stretch of the imagination. So, like, you know, they have to be, you know, amazing. You know, I just wish that was kind of interesting. Huh?
I wish I was that good.
Exactly. Right. Yeah. No, I mean, especially, you know, to be that good and to be able to do stuff in, you know, one take, you know, it's just, and make it feel good too, you know.
Yeah. I liked recordings when I was in American Heartbreak. I liked going in the studio because I knew the songs backwards and forwards because I had a big hand in writing a lot of them. But and that was always fun.
Yeah. Now, do you guys play to a click? Like, how do you approach it?
We probably did. It's a drummer did with the click. I can't play to a click really. It's drummer's problem.
Yeah, and you just played to him, right? Yeah.
Yeah, so, he had the click in his head, and I just followed along to him.
Yeah, that's a good way to do it. Yeah, I wish, you know, we could afford and had the time to play live, but we don't ever really get a chance to do that, you know, in the studio.
Yeah, that's the easiest way is when the band's in the same room doing basic tracks together.
Yeah, you know, to get, you know.
I don't know how you could, when you're in the studio as a drummer, are you playing along to scratch guitars or something?
Well, the way we have done it is in this, you know, in Cream Circus is normally it's just, we've had the bass player in there at one point, but it just was easier just to do guitars. Yeah, I'm playing to a scratch. So we'll go in to figure out what the tempo should be. Chris has made very, very elaborate demos. So,
okay.
So we use that as reference. Unfortunately, we always give him a hard time because he never writes down what the BPM is, so we have to figure out what it is. But then he'll cut a rhythm track, and then usually I'll play to that rhythm track while he, like, does a scratch vocal, and that's how usually we get. And I think they sound pretty live. I think it does, you know, we try not to get too bogged down in making it perfect, just, you know, just so long as it, you know, feels good. You know?
Yeah, I would think it would be nearly impossible as a drummer just to go in there and not have any scratch tracks, right?
Yeah, yeah. And it's funny, having, oddly enough, his rhythm playing is so good that, you know, it's kind of nice as far as what I'm hearing in my headphones. It's very uncluttered just to hear rhythm and a scratch vocal. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, you know, and everyone's different. Every situation is different. But in this situation, it works really well. Because, you know, a lot of times when you have everyone playing and you don't have a good mix and you have a click, it's really kind of hard to focus. So at least, you know, once again, not being someone that does this day in and day out, you know, I don't, it's, I find it easier than when the mix is a lot less cluttered to really lay down where, find out, you know, find that rhythm, for, you know, so. But yeah, it'd be nice to play. I wish we could be in a nice big room and play together. That would be pretty awesome.
So you haven't rehearsed in a year, so you're going to be, you guys are going to be a little bit rusty when it comes time. Have you guys already been offered gigs once this thing's over?
No, we had one thing. It's happening in Baltimore in September. It's like this outdoor benefit thing, this little thing that we've done in the past. That's the only thing we have. We, you know, we had like five or six, you know, things lined up in, in the summer. You know, I'm sure you did too. And it was kind of heartbreaking that not to do them. And, so,
well, now everybody's planning on shit opening up in California, and all the bands that I'm playing in are getting tons of offers already.
That's great. That's great. I'm glad. I miss, believe me, I miss going to see music too. You know, I mean, that's, you know, whatever.
What's that?
It's just such a, I miss actually just going to see music.
Yeah,
too,
me too.
Know?
Yeah. So, well, I had I was going to go see The Darkness Were Coming in April of last year.
Yeah.
So I don't, we'll see what happens. I'm looking forward to, hopefully people will show up to the gigs. It's going to be interesting on Saturday to see how it is with a room full of biker dudes. I may catch the Corova this one. I might die after this show. Who knows?
So you haven't been vaccinated? Are you not?
Yeah, I'd rather not say.
Okay.
I'm waiting. I'm giving it a little bit more time before I do it.
I totally understand.
I'm not anti-vaxxer. I'm not against getting the vaccine. I'll wait till the lines go down a little bit. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
There's other people who need it more than me. I take so many fucking vitamins and wash my hands so often. I don't think that I'm.
Yeah.
But Ted Nugent just got it, so we'll see. He did it. Yeah, I know he got it because he did a gig in Waco, Texas. He played at a club with some other guys, and about a week and a half after that gig is when he got it. So I'm pretty sure that's where he got it, playing a gig. So if I'm going to get it, I'm going to get it Saturday night at a Hell's Angels thing, because there ain't going to be no guys wearing masks at that fucking thing. I guarantee you.
I think you're right. So can you go through your whole vitamin regimen, like much like Keith Morrison did? Like, remember how he was talking about? I'm joking.
Okay, I get up. I can. I'll go. In the morning, I get. Did he do his vitamin regimen? I forget.
No, but it was funny because I couldn't tell if he was being serious or
he's probably
just
bullshitting. But who knows?
But it was amazing. Like, he was. It was great. I really enjoyed it.
I probably went over mine with him when he went over. But I'll tell you again, for everybody who's listening, I get up in the morning. I go make my coffee. I bring my coffee down to my podcast studio, and I look at all the blogs and whatever in the morning, and wake up, get ready for school, for work. I take vitamin C, vitamin D, D3 or so. I don't know. D complex. I take fish oil, lion's mane tincture, which is a mushroom, lion's mane mushroom tincture.
Hey, did you get that from that Tackett's guy, that mushroom guy?
I went on a mushroom hunt, a guided mushroom hunt, and we went on this guy's property who cultivates lion's mane mushrooms, and he makes the tincture. So I got it from him.
And what is that supposedly helpful for?
Lion's mane, actually mushrooms in general, are very good for immunity. As a matter of fact, they are used for immunotherapy for cancer patients, which a lot of cancer patients don't know.
Yeah.
I
take lion's mane too.
Oh, you
I got
do?
It.
Tincture?
Well, I think it is. I forget what it is. There's a guy who was... who was on, oddly enough, on Joe Rogan's show, who's like the mushroom guy.
Yeah, I heard. Well, the funny you say that. The mushroom guy, the mushroom
Tackett,
hunt.
That, Paul Tackett or Taggett, something like that is the name.
I went on a mushroom hunt, and that guy referenced Paul, the guy that was on Joe Rogan's podcast.
Yeah, he's fascinating, man. He's got some incredible stories about just mushrooms.
So supposedly mushrooms have very benefic anti-cancer benefits. So and also I went to I take my old man friend Don from the dog park to grocery outlet every week.
Yeah.
And they have all kinds of weird groceries and shit. They had lion's mane mushroom powder in a bag.
Wow, yeah.
I bought 2 bags of that. So I also have that. And that's just also just as good as tincture. So anyway, so take mushroom. So we started with vitamin C, vitamin D3, lion's mane tincture, black elderberry, some kind of super expensive multivitamin.
Yeah.
And fish oil. And if I'm feeling something coming on, I will take a handful of olive leaf extract too.
Yeah, okay.
So I take a handful of vitamins every morning.
That's
so
good.
I don't know if it's working, but it ain't hurting, I don't think.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I hear you. Now, I'm a firm believer in vitamins.
I have a feeling that those handful of vitamins, I mean, I don't want to come across like as a far right Republican or anything, but I have a feeling that that handful of vitamins is more beneficial than a vaccine that's not been FDA approved. But that's besides the point. I will get the vaccine eventually.
Yeah.
I don't have it yet. I'm sure you have it, right? Have you posted on Facebook that you got vaccinated?
I have to say that I'm although I'm a big fan of Facebook, I am not a big fan of people posting that kind of stuff.
You didn't post
so
a picture
not,
of your arm with the Band-Aid
no,
on it?
I did not.
And then
I
under
did,
the,
I,
go ahead.
No, I did get it. I just got it like sort of last minute. I found one. Actually, at the Johnson & Johnson.
One and done.
Right before they banned it. They pulled it off the market. Yeah. But
and you don't think Pfizer has anything to do with that, do you?
Okay. I don't know.
I'm getting into conspiracy theory. I'm going to be Keith Morris.
I love the fact that he has that podcast. I've been meaning to check that out. He's incredibly entertaining.
I love all the Facebook photos. They show their Band-Aid, and then underneath it has COVID-19 vaccination information. Facebook.
That's a bit weird. Yeah, I don't know. Like I said, I'm a big fan of Facebook. I want it all the time, but it's something I just didn't feel like sharing with
and
everyone.
One more far right wing bullshit before I get off. Isn't it funny when Trump was president, all these people who are vaccination braggarts were anti-vaxxers in December of 2020? That's all I'm saying, okay?
Really? I don't think I noticed that, but that's very possible.
Well, okay. But anyway, I will get the vaccine. It's just I'm not ready. I'll get it when I have to. When I'm ready to go to a Giants game, when I want to go to a Giants game, I'll get the vaccine.
Well, I just hope you don't get sick at this at this game.
Yeah, me too. Yeah. I'll probably be wishing that I got vaccinated.
Yeah. No, I hear you. To each his own, man. Like, you know,
I'll get it. It's another thing about it. I don't care who's president about the vaccine. I don't like anybody telling me I have to do something. I've never been a good rule follower. Somebody tells me you got to do something, I'm going to make sure I don't do it. That's why I sneak beer into the Giants game.
Wow. What does it cost for a beer at a Giants game?
It's like 12, 13 bucks.
Oh, my God. Yeah. I guess it's pretty much the same here, but man, it just blows me away.
Yeah. So anyway, I will get the vaccine. So I'm not anti-vaxxer. I'm not anti-Biden. I'm not anti-this and anti-that.
No, I hear you. I hear you. It's all good.
I haven't gotten it yet. That's all. Yeah, but when people ask me if I got it, when I'm on the street, like I'm on a job, you get the vaccine? I go, yeah, I got the vaccine. Yeah, I got it. You get both shots? Yeah, I got 2 shots. Yeah.
Yeah, well, it was just sort of ironic. I finally got around to trying to get one, and I got one very easily. Just I looked into one, and then of course they they 2 days later they pull it off market. But
oh,
not
you got
from
it
what
just
I
in
had,
time because I heard the second.
Well, I mean, yeah, I had no side effects whatsoever too. So it was
good.
Very 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 easy going.
Hopefully in 6 months you don't develop, you won't come up come
yeah,
down with
yeah,
age or something.
And, yeah.
Because I listen to No Agenda, Adam Curry's podcast, and they talk about they play so many fucking clips, and it gets me so fucking scared and shit. And I gotta stop doing that. Whatever.
So wait, what, I'm sorry. They do what on that show?
They talk about. They play all these clips about people. I don't know. They
about,
talk about how it's bull. They play clips from other all these other people who I don't know. I'm not going to get into it. I'm a loose subscriber.
I'm curious. It's sort of stuff where people have gotten vaccinated and bad things have happened.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Adam Curry, huh?
You know who that is?
Wasn't he an MTV guy?
Yeah, he was my boss when I worked at a podcasting company for a while. Show, and it became Mevio.
Right.
Yeah. He does a show called No Agenda. Check it out. Listen to one episode of No Agenda, and you'll understand why I get a little scared.
Now I'm afraid to listen.
Anyway, I'm not that scared. I mean, I'm not that worried about it. Just I don't see any need to right now. Although, like I said, I'm playing a fucking Hell's Angels party, and I'm going to get sick and die now.
No.
We'll see. I'll get this posted before Saturday.
No, the thing for me though is like there's so many variables involved, right? Like that's the scary thing about the virus, right? Certain people makes them really sick, certain people doesn't make them sick at all. You know, and that's so it's hard to know what to believe.
Yeah.
You know.
When I have the news on, see, this is mad at dad shit here. When I have the news on, there's a different story every day. There's two different, I look at these news apps on my phone. There's one story about this, it's everything's safe here. And then next story, it's bad and you can wear a mask. And next story, it's deadly to wear a mask. And meanwhile, I'm wearing a mask and my glasses are fogging up and I'm bumping into walls. And the guy at the grocery store is yelling at me for not having the mask pulled over my nose. And I get pissed off because I don't like being told what to do, and then I just say fuck you everybody and fuck you, you're making me pull the mask over my nose, and fuck you, I ain't getting the vaccine, these guys are making me wear a mask on my nose, and I turn into a punk rocker and but I'll get the fucking thing.
Do you normally get flu shots, or is that something you don't do either?
No, I don't get flu shots. I haven't had the flu since I've discovered black elderberry and olive leaf extract. I haven't gotten the flu in probably 7 years.
Yeah.
Because I'm convinced it's because I take those hippie drugs.
No, I definitely think there's very, there's a lot of validity in that. My father actually was a big vitamin guy. I grew up with that.
So you've unsubscribed. Right, you've clicked unsubscribe at this point, right, to the Rock and Roll Geek Show since I'm an anti-vaxxer?
No, not me.
I'm not an anti-vaxxer, and I will get the vaccine. There's just people that...
Hey, listen.
I drive by, and there's a line down the fucking block of guys, of people waiting to get the vaccine. I'll wait till the lines die down a little bit. Then I'll get it. Besides, my daughter's not going to let me see my grandkid when she has a baby until I'm vaccinated. So I'm not going to be able to fly to see her anyway before I get vaccinated. So I'll have to. So yeah. I'll get the fucking thing if I don't die before then.
All right.
Boy, bring the show down.
So what do you want to do at this point? I don't know. I feel like
Can I pick one of them?
Yeah, absolutely. I would love that.
How about The Boys? What's that angel tune? Good Time Fanny. I've never heard that angel tune.
Oh, that's not the angel. This is not a band. No, it's
because it's got the angel logo on that on the album art.
Really? No, I don't think. No, this is a British glam band that Mick Tucker at the drummer from the Suite, and and what's his face, Andy Scott produced. And it's funny because it sounds just like a Suite song, and that's why I kind of love it.
I'll play that then.
Yeah, it's and also just real quick, I'm pretty sure the word fanny has a little bit of a different meaning in the UK as well.
Well, probably about the band Fanny.
I don't know. I mean, I've always heard that fanny at least was kind of meant pussy.
Probably, the fact that they would write a song
called Good Time Fanny is like, yeah. Like,
maybe that's where the band Fanny got their name from, too.
Well, even like Sweet F.A., when they say Sweet Fanny Adams, I don't know, it's obviously Sweet Fuck All.
I did not know F.A. standing for Fanny Adams, stood for Fanny
Well,
Adams.
It meant Fuck All. I mean, I think it meant Sweet Fuck All, but they called the album Sweet Fanny Adams because they couldn't call it Fuck All, but I don't know. Anyways, this song is really, it's really cool, but it's just funny because it could literally just be a Sweet single, like that Chin and Chapman wrote. It's a lot of fun.
Okay, here's Angel featuring Andy Scott and Steve Priest. Well, Mick Tucker,
they produced it. Probably played on it too, but the band's called Angel.
Okay, and then we'll come back. We'll say some parting words, and we'll play another tune, and we'll get the hell out of here.
Sounds good.
All right, here's Angel, not to be confused with Punky Meadows. Angel, Good Time Fanny.
Take a look at yourself and then rock and roll with Fanny. Jim, Jim, good time Fanny, good time Fanny. Jim, Jim, good time Fanny, good time Fanny.
Fanny
I've never heard that before either. That sounds good. The singer sounds exactly like Brian Connolly from Sweet.
I know. Exactly. Doesn't it? That's why it's like so funny. I mean, it, once again, could be a lost Sweet single. Yeah. I'm glad you liked it. Yeah, it's cool. I thought that was a cool tune.
Did they put out an album or just a couple of singles, I wonder?
I think it's just a couple of singles. I'm not an authority in all this stuff. These obscure glam singles, but you know, once again, there are always these. It's always cool when you find these little gems.
Yeah.
Absolutely cool.
That's good. Angel. All right.
Hey, I guess we better wrap it up, man. I feel bad. I don't want to torture people any longer. So.
Nobody's tortured. Nobody's tortured. People can all they have to do is hit stop. They probably hit stop when I started on the rant about the.
No, I love your rant. So
there really wasn't a rant anyway.
That was not. No, I mean, that's a little very. You know,
I listened to an interview with. This guy, Steve Cropper, was on.
Oh, sure, yes.
Bob Lefsetz, and Bob Lefsetz asked him about the vaccine, and he said, two people told me can tell me what to do. And that's my mom and dad, and I don't let make anybody else tell me what to do. That's kind of the way I feel.
Is that the guitar player, Steve Cropper?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Cool.
Anyway, it has nothing to do with politics at all. It's just. I don't like being told what to do. If you tell me I can't, like my wife tells me I can't drink a beer or smoke pot in the house. First thing I'm going to do when she leaves the house, I'm going to light up a joint. All right.
That's funny.
Not because I want to, just because I was told I can't.
Yeah. I definitely.
It's like when they told me I couldn't masturbate in the boys' bathroom in high school. No, I'm kidding. All right.
Nice.
Rob Giglio. Is he Giglio?
Giglio.
No. Italian?
Yes.
Is that your Italian?
Yeah.
My mom's maiden name was Camerata. So.
Yeah.
Do you make Sunday gravy?
No, but my grandmother, yes. Both my mom's mother was Italian. So
is your wife Italian?
No, she's German.
Oh, Italians and German, that's a good combination. Sausage.
Yeah, exactly.
I love German food.
Yeah, she's amazing. Amazing. She's a good kid, my wife. So very glad to have her.
So, Rob Giglio, thank you for doing this. I had a good time. I hope you did. Hope you felt like you got your value.
Oh, absolutely. I really appreciate it. It was a lot of fun. I always wanted to chat with you and talk music, and we got to do that. So, it's a win-win.
Hopefully, someday we'll meet in person and we'll have do you drink beer?
Absolutely.
Hopefully someday we'll meet in person. We'll have a beer and Chris DePinto as well and talk guitar.
Yeah. And honestly, anytime you're in town, man, I mean, obviously, you know, with COVID, but they get together. I got plenty of room in my house. You can come crash. I have a little practice space in the basement. We could jam.
Sounds like fun.
And I got a beer full fridge down here too. So.
All right. So how can
I beer full fridge? I'm sorry, fridge full. Beer.
Whatever, we get it. So any plugs you would like to do?
I mean, other than people could check out the Cream Circus or Beretta 76. That would be really swell. And I guess it's the only I can the Beretta 76 put out an EP a couple months ago, and the Cream Circus record came out roughly in the past year. Been cool to have two things out I guess to check those two things out, that'd be awesome.
Should we close with a Cream Circus tune?
I put a Beretta song on there. I know
did you?
So,
did you?
Yeah.
I didn't see it. Hold on, let me look for it. Hold on a second.
This was I put one on here just in case. I figured if we play it last.
Okay Blue Sky.
Yeah, sort of. I don't know. I'm just absolutely very happy with this song. So,
all right, we'll play
So hopefully people will dig it. So thanks again, my man, and definitely stay in touch, and I'll be listening.
Well, Rob Giglio, thank you for doing this. And friends, if you would like to co-host the show, you heard Rob. Are you thinking of doing a podcast now that you got? Because a lot of times people would co-host the show and then say, "See, I enjoy it. This is good. I'm gonna start my own podcast." Have you thought about doing that?
I mean, of course, I've thought about it, but I also realize that it's not very easy to, so I'm not going to go do it. Let's do it that way.
Well, if you do, I hope you don't abandon the Rock and Roll Geek Show like most people do.
Absolutely not. I will not.
Most of the people, when they are friends of the Rock and Roll Geek Show, and then they decide to start their own podcast, and they decide that the Rock and Roll Geek Show now sucks. So maybe they have finally discovered that the Rock and Roll Geek Show now sucks. But thank you, Rob, for doing this.
And then thank you.
Friends, if you would like to do this, rockandrollgeek.com is where you can find out how. It's easy. And it's fun, and I'm a good guy. And you can even come to my house. I'll make you dinner and crash with you. By the way, Rob, if you're ever in San Francisco, you and the wife or whatever, we got a spare room here. You guys are welcome to come here, and I'll make you dinner.
I appreciate that. I love San Francisco. I mean, it's a place to come visit. So
you should see the shit on the streets and the tents now. It's really enjoyable. Yeah. Okay.
I can imagine. It wasn't like that.
it wasn't like that when I. It's a beautiful town still, though. Where I live, it's beautiful. I'm right by the beach, so you won't see that.
And Amoeba Music's still around, right?
What's that?
I think Amoeba
might have shut down. I haven't been on Hate Street lately. But the Amoeba in L.A. is open still. I'm not sure. Maybe Amoeba... I think it might have closed right before the pandemic. I could be wrong.
Let's hope not. That's a cool place. Yeah, I understand. Yeah, it's probably very touristy, but it was a fun place to go, though, when you were in town. So.
All right, Rob. Well, thank you for doing this. And
thanks again.
If I don't get this posted tonight, which I probably won't because it's almost 9 o'clock now. I got to get up in the morning. But I will have this posted by tomorrow night. So thanks again for doing this. I really appreciate it.
Right.
And keep in touch with me, friend.
Absolutely. Thanks again.
Here's Beretta 76. Thank you for listening, friends. You know how to reach me the usual ways, and it's a value for value. Please keep the donations coming, because without your donations, this show would die a horrible, putrid, stench-filled death. Rob, if you want to stay on until after the show, and then I'll just say bye to you in person if you want.
Okay.
All right.
Sounds good.
Beretta 66. I'll talk to you soon, friends. I'm thinking about doing a show this weekend. I'm thinking of doing the Greta Van Fleet track by track. That should be good for a laugh. All right. All right. Thank you for listening, friends. I'll talk to you soon. Here's Beretta 66 featuring Rob Giglio. Sorry. It's not Beretta 66. It's Beretta 76, you fucking asshole. All right. Here's Beretta 76, starting it over.
I know. It's a rock and roll geek train wreck.